previously on War and Remembrance.
My name is Victor Henry.
Captain Pug Henry's family is scattered in the aftermath of Pearl Harbor.
Gentlemen, I want to bomb Japan.
His son Warren, a pilot on the carrier Enterprise.
Here we go!
Younger son Byron, on a submarine somewhere in the Pacific.
He's coming back, sir.
And Byron's wife, Natalie, trapped with her uncle by the Nazi occupation.
Neither you nor Professor Jastrow understand just how fraught with peril your situation is.
My wife and kid may be caught in Europe.
We're heading out to fight one hell of a big battle.
When you come back, and you will, I'll be here.
I want you to promise never to see my husband again.
I can't do that.
Hitler orders the beginning of his final solution.
The Germans are committing mass murder, perhaps genocide under the cover of war.
But Aaron's cousin, Beryl Jastrow, escapes while half a world away.
A victory in the Pacific. We need a huge victory now.
The war costs Pug his battleship, as well as the life of his son. A brief reunion for Natalie and Byron.
I'm convinced I can get him on a plane with me back to the States.
It marks the beginning of a nightmare.
As of 5 a.m. this morning, the borders are closed.
What?
I should have gone with Byron. Oh, God, why didn't I go with him?
It was for Natalie, wasn't it?
Pug's new duty takes him to Moscow, while Natalie finds herself imprisoned at a place known as the Paradise Ghetto.
The boy would be taken to the children's home.
Oh, my God.
And now...
November 25th, 1943.
Theresienstadt, Czechoslovakia. The Paradise Ghetto. The most fantastic and monstrous hoax in the history of the world. After a lapse of months, I resumed this journal at the risk of my life. If this were found, I would be taken outside the ghetto walls to the dreaded prison known as the Little Fortress. And there in the SS dungeons and torture chambers, I would die a frightful death. But I undertake this risk because there are things I must bear witness to. Terrible things. Things that must be recorded. Therese in itself is an old army town. From the outside, quite a pretty place, with its picturesque stone houses and barracks. That is, if one does not look beyond the walls at the crowds of sick, hungry, and dying inhabitants. Nightclubs do exist. There's nothing to eat or drink, but comedians and musicians abound. The operas, lectures, concerts, and plays do go on. I've even lectured myself. Of windows full of goods stolen from the half-dead throngs drifting by. But naturally, nothing is for sale. This colossal fraud helps support the Nazi claims that the Jewish camps in the East are all like Theresienstadt, just not quite so luxurious. In reality, it is like a town on the edge of a disaster area, overrun with refugees, except that the disaster keeps mounting and the refugees keep piling in. Their numbers relieved only by the enormous daily mortality rate from starvation and disease. But the most terrifying aspect is the fearful black cloud that hangs over every Jew in Theresienstadt. Transport to the East. For the Paradise Ghetto is really nothing but a transit camp. They call a Schleuse, a sluice or floodgate, to the East. But what happens to those who are shipped to the East? Nobody knows. However, certain people are exempt. Jewish officials, decorated war veterans, and people in special work like my library. And the place where Natalie works, the mica factory. It is hell, that place, but Natalie has become used to it. Natalie has changed. She is no more an American Jewess, terrified of falling into German hands. Her whole being has a single focus now, to make it through with Lewis and live. Separated from her in the toddler's home amid several hundred children, regimented by strange women in this damp, dark old stone house where the mortality is terrible, Lewis is thriving like a weed. Whether his travels have hardened him, or, as Natalie often thinks, the crossbreeding of the tough Jastros and the tough Henrys has produced a Darwinian super survivor, Lewis is Lewis. Blazing with vitality.
Lewis!
Wie geht?
Gut. Es geht gut.
I got potato soup. From rotten frozen potatoes, the SS kitchen threw out. Specialty of Uden. Delicious. Come, upstairs.
Mm.
They won't have a puppet show tonight. After this drink, Walter. Mm. I have some new jokes. Can we rehearse now?
You know, I teach English class at 7.
It's simple stuff, won't take long.
All right. After the soup.
Suffering defeats on every front.
The Eskimos again! Why can't they be stopped? How many times have I ordered them annihilated?
But, Your Highness, there are so many of them, and they will not cooperate.
That's no excuse, you damned incompetent! If you can't kill them all, I'll find someone who can!
Funny. Everybody loved it.
Well, Udam's a remarkable fellow. We both know Natalie. But I warned you before, this is a very dangerous business.
Oh, do you think the Germans give a damn how we Jews amuse ourselves? Aaron, what's this? Where did these come from?
Those things arrived a little while ago. Epstein came with them to explain.
Epstein himself?
Yes, the eldester, the highest elder, none other.
What did he say?
We're to go to SS headquarters tomorrow, but there's no danger. It's a good sign. We're due for more special privileges. He swears that, Natalie.
Why do we have to go to SS headquarters?
For an audience with Standartenfuhrer Eichmann.
Eichmann?
Yes, quite an honor. So you see, these clothes are rather an encouraging sign, don't you think so, Natalie? Somebody at least wants us to look our best. So let's try to do that, shall we, dear? And start off by getting a good night's rest. Standartenfuhrer Eichmann. A remote, evil name. Only whispered around the ghetto. Despite the modest rank, a figure of terror, standing not far below Himmler and Hitler. I believe we are about to find out why we are in Theresienstadt. May God, who owes nothing to a stiff-necked old heretic, help me to protect Natalie and Louis. The one reason for me to go on living.
You look very chic and pretty, Mrs. Henry. Eichmann.
You like working at the mica factory?
I'm very glad to be working there.
Your health?
Thank you, it's good.
Your son looks well. It seems the children of Theresienstadt are well treated.
He's very well.
And you, Professor, you've quite ill in Paris.
I have recovered.
Is your treatment in Theresienstadt?
Good.
No complaints?
None.
I suppose the two of you are wondering why you're here.
Yes, sir, we are.
I will explain. Your impetuous flight from Italy put us in a very awkward position. When you turned up in Paris, the Italian secret police wanted to take you back immediately. Now, that would have complicated negotiations for the exchange of the Baden-Baden group and also would have meant your death. So, it occurred to me that sending you and your niece to Theresienstadt, while delaying the Italians by taking their demands under advisement, was the most considerate solution. Don't you agree, Professor?
We're very grateful for your consideration in the matter, Herr Steinblatt.
Yes, good. Well, I always try to be as fair and humane as possible in carrying out the strict Jewish policies of the Führer, which, of course, I totally agree with. Now, to the matter in hand. Professor, you are satisfied with the Paradise Ghetto, Yes? I am not satisfied. Oh, no. Over the next 3 weeks, you will see a great beautification here, which you, as a very special permanent, will be part of, and you will benefit from, you and your niece and her little son.
Oh, yes. As part of the great beautification, the Council of Elders is creating a new Department of Culture. And we want to elect you an elder to head this department. Your fine lectures and your famous and American author make you the right man.
This was obviously Eichmann's idea. But the last thing I wanted was to become one of these elders who, for a few privileges, inflict on fellow Jews the harsh decrees of the SS.
Well, Professor?
May I inquire, sir, have I any choice in the matter?
If you do not have a choice, Dr. Jester, this whole conversation has been pointless. Now, I'm a very busy man, but it would seem a fine job for you.
With respect, sir, my health is frail. My work in the library occupies much of my time and energy. If I may, sir, I would like to decline.
Yes, of course you may. We will say no more about it. There is one other matter to be discussed. Also, keeping the little boy from his playmates. Think you are? And where do you think you are? Bill! Speak up!
I'll tell you what you are. You're nothing but an old bag of filthy Jewish scheiße. Why, you stinking old pile of garbage. You think you were still in America? You are in Theresienstadt! Understand? Get that in that stupid old shithead! Get up on your knees. Now tell me who you are. Now say what you are.
I am an old bag of filthy Jewish shits.
Scream it, Jew. Scream it at the top of your lungs, or I'll kick you until you do scream it!
I am an old bag of filthy Jewish shits.
All right. Get up. You, help him. Take off his glasses.
Please, don't worry. I beg of you, please, don't. Will be.
Sit up.
No, it will be. Will be.
So, tell us about your niece's filthy puppet shows attacking the Fuhrer.
Oh, yes. Yes, we know about them.
And the Talmud classes you have been teaching in defiance of the rules of the camp? Offenses punishable by death?
If I may be permitted...
Silence! By your crimes, you have forfeited any claim to the status of interned enemy alien. You are just another Theresienstadt Jew. Do you understand? Still, you would be useful as an elder in charge of culture. And your niece does have a good report from the Leica factory. So,
if I may be permitted to reconsider, I would be honored to accept the post of elder.
Your acceptance is entirely voluntary, correct?
Of course, Herr Standarten Führer.
As you will breathe nothing different to anyone. And if you do, I shall find out. That will be the end of you and your niece and the brat.
As you order, Herr Standartenführer.
That is all.
What happened?
Nothing.
I have accepted Eichmann's offer to become the elder in charge of culture.
What did they do to you?
God forgive me for not letting them kill me. But if I were to have died, what hope would there be for Natalie and Lewis? But what hope is there indeed? It is now painfully evident in this public use of my name and face that we are at last hopelessly beyond diplomatic rescue of any kind. Since leaving Siena, I have carried a well-concealed pouch as a last resort, containing the photocopied documents of my earlier conversion to Catholicism, my ace in the hole, as it were, to save me from a bad fate as a Jew. But this morning, for the first time in perhaps 50 years, I put on phylacteries borrowed from a pious old man next door, and I mean to do this in all the days remaining to me on this sick and stricken earth, taking it all in from that moment in my youth when I turned my back on my religion until this morning when I entered SS headquarters. I've spent my life on the run. Now I turn and stand. I am a Jew. Thus, I answer Eichmann.
Дядя Миша, ты легенда. Даже в наушнице о вас говорили. А эти все тоже евреи?
Да.
Это пленки об осенцеве. Они все еще у вас.
Да. У меня есть человек в Праге, который может их передать американцам.
Тогда ты должен ехать в Прагу.
Конечно.
Когда ты окрепнешь, и тебя сведут с людьми, которые тебя переврят в Прагу. Твоим работником будет Громко.
Прекрасно.
Здравствуй.
Ну, тебе сейчас надо отдохнуть.
Это правда.
Anyone else but me, no, 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 don't sit under the apple tree. With anyone else but me, till I come marching home. Don't go walking down Lover's Lane with anyone else but me, anyone else but me, anyone else but me, no, 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 don't go walking down Lover's Lane with anyone else but me, till I come marching home. Just got word from a girl who heard from the girl next door to me.
Poor Valentina. Not having a very nice time at her own party, is she?
How can you blame her? Being married to that one can't ever be easy.
Excuse me. Phil's all right. He just likes the ladies and booze a little too much.
Yes. Pity Captain Henry's stuck downstairs.
Oh, you know Pug?
Quite well. He and my father are good friends.
Say, you know, they should be starting to carry them out of that meeting just about now. Why don't I see if I can find them?
Glad.
Lucky I got there when I did. Almost missed it. I think I'll go dancing.
Yeah.
American general drinks vodka.
Uh-oh. We could have a problem here. Fitzgerald's not a drinker.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Is there any more of this vodka around here?
There's another couple of bottles in there, General.
There goes one for old Glory Bug.
Now, General, we'll see who can really drink some vodka. Cummins. Down a half.
Four thumbs up.
Up bottom.
Come on, come on.
Stansbury. So you will marry Air Vice Marshal Lord Duncan Burnvilk, who stole 40 air cobras from us. Evo?
Sprasitsi, Evo.
No, mi priatli.
What was that?
I just told him we were good friends.
You're in Moscow, dear lady, because he got your visa. Henry, their boots, Loroku.
Their boots, Loroku!
Nebu Dorakom, don't be... What? What's Dorakom?
Damn fool.
I see.
Morning. I don't change much.
I don't love Dunk.
Why are you marrying a man you don't love?
Because I'm sick of floating about. Even more now Torquay's dead, now I have nobody.
When will you leave?
Any time. And I'm packing in the press job. I'd better be off to India and get on with my life.
Stay a week. What's a week?
Shall we be lovers?
You're engaged to be married. I've got Rhoda.
Are you sure you've got Rhoda?
What is it? You want to say something? What is it? The night I met you at the British Embassy, you told me you'd run into Rhoda in Washington.
I did, several times, in fact, but...
Was she ever with an army colonel? A fellow named Peters, Harrison Peters, tall, good-looking fellow. Ever since I've been back, I've been getting those damn letters. I tried to ignore them.
Why do you read such filth?
I only opened one. I tore the rest of them up and threw them away. But it mentioned Peters.
All right, I don't know anything. But one night at a big dance, I did run into Rhoda, and she was with a tall, attractive man in an army uniform. He was escorting her.
Peters.
It was very correct, very casual. She even introduced him.
You said you saw her several times with him?
Yes, once or twice, on similar occasions. Victor, a woman can't go to a dance without an escort.
Where was this? When? Tell me, I want to know.
Don't do this to me, Victor. You don't want my love. You've said so. It's hopeless. It always has been. For God's sake, let's just forget it. Let me be. Let me get on with my life.
Don't marry Duncan.
I most certainly will.
No. Not till I go back to Washington and find out where Rhoda stands.
It won't make any difference, I tell you. I'm committed to him. I couldn't hurt him. It wouldn't be fair.
You don't love the man.
Go back to your wife. There's a bond between the two of you that nothing can break, nothing. Not since Warren died.
Will you stay the week?
The Allied war leaders gather in Tehran to map out the next historic phase of the war. Overcoming Churchill's last objections, Franklin Roosevelt pushes through Operation Overlord, the cross-channel invasion of France. It is set for the spring of 1944. Stalin, in return, guarantees a synchronized all-out smash from the east. Roosevelt also extracts from Marshal Stalin the promise of an attack on Japan once Germany is defeated and the Soviet Union's pledge to join a post-war United Nations. In the space of 3 days of roundtable meetings, lasting but a few hours, Franklin Roosevelt gets almost everything he comes for. It is perhaps his finest hour.
Pretty sober reception. Where's my welcome home drink?
Byron, there's a letter from Natalie. It was forwarded by the Red Cross.
Terezin, where is that?
Czechoslovakia, near Prague. I've telephoned my father about this. He's talked to the State Department. Read your letter first.
This September 7th, that's almost 4 months old.
Dearest Byron, special privilege for prominence. Monthly 100-word letter. Louis, wonderful. Aaron, all right. My spirit's good. Right here. Red Cross food packages, extremely desirable. Don't worry. Terrasenstadt's special haven for privileged. We have second floor, sunny apartment. Best here. Aaron, librarian. Louis, kindergarten star, also chief troublemaker. My war factory work takes scale, not brawn. Love you, heart, soul. Live for day, hold you in arms. Telephone my mother. Love. Love, Natalie.
What did your father find out?
You're gonna call State right away.
I'm gonna try to call Sloat, too.
Byron, what did Natalie say? Is she all right?
Read it. Then tell me what you think. Yes, operator, I'd like to place a call to Washington, D.C., the State Department, for Mr. Sylvester Ahern. The number is capital 4973.
Hmm. Well, quite a ray of light your wife's letter is, isn't it? Reassuring all in all, very reassuring.
Definitely gives us something to work on. You must air mail a copy to us at once.
Mr. Ahern, what do you know about this place? Are my wife and baby safe there?
Well, after hearing from Senator Lacouture, I did some checking. The Red Cross has no record of any releases from the model ghetto, but the Jastrow case is unique. I'd prefer to remain optimistic.
Oh, you would you? Well, why don't you just tell me what you're doing about getting them out of there?
Please, Lieutenant. Considering your wife is Jewish and was traveling illegally in German-occupied territory, she's fortunate to have landed where she is.
Look, just switch me over to Leslie Sloat's office, huh?
Ah, Leslie Sloat. Leslie resigned from the State Department quite a while ago.
Resign?
Yes.
All right, where can I reach him?
I'm sorry, I can't say.
Excuse me, Lieutenant, I have another call.
Keep in touch, by all means.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Myron.
Hey.
How's Janice?
She's good. You been over to CompSub back?
Oh, yeah. Admiral was okay. I didn't have to do a war dance. We got our electric torpedoes and a target ship for practice runs.
That's terrific.
You bet it is. Short turnaround. It's back to the Sea of Japan. Tomorrow, captain's inspection. Friday, Admiral Nimitz is coming aboard to give the crew a unit citation for the first patrol. Huh? Saturday, underway at 0600 for electric torpedo exercise. What do you sit down in the mouth about, anyway?
Ma, I'm just trying to get some word on Natalie. Listen, Skipper, I thought we'd be getting a phone over from the dock today, but it's not hooked up yet. Will you give Janice a ring while you're ashore and tell her to call me at the O Club at 2200?
Yeah, sure, you bet.
Thanks.
Byron, is that you? Gosh, I can hardly hear you. It's so noisy. Where are you? Okay, well, get a pencil. You're going to need to write this down. Ready? Leslie Sloat will be waiting for your call tomorrow at 1. That's 7 a.m. our time, you know?
Great. Give me the number.
It's CA9164.
Right, got it.
Did you talk to him?
No, actually, it was the Lieutenant Commander Anderson who tracked him down and called me back. Do you know him, Simon Anderson?
Yeah, he's an old beau of Madeline's.
Oh, well, he was at the house when I called. Listen, Byron, can you come to lunch tomorrow?
No, can do. I've got captain's inspection.
Well, call me back and tell me what Sloat says.
I will.
Briny, are you okay?
Yeah, I'm all right. Thanks a lot.
Still playing games with Byron while Natalie's in a damn concentration camp.
Just shut up.
What do you think that this little charade of yours is all about? You honestly think that Byron needs protection from the facts of life?
You don't know anything about Byron. And besides, I didn't say Natalie was in a concentration camp.
Oh, yes, you did.
Czechoslovakia, you said that.
Too drunk to know what I said. Listen, I'm sorry you had a disappointing patrol, but don't take it out on me.
I gotta hand it to you, you know that? You know that Byron is half in love with you, and that suits you just fine. And here we are in some hiding in some damn motel room. So that you can keep stringing Uncle Briny along. You're having your cake and eating it too, aren't you, babe?
What if I just go home?
How about you do whatever the hell you want to do?
There's nothing that anybody can do. We don't know very much about Theresienstadt, you know, except that it does exist.
Maybe it is a haven for her. I just can't tell you. Look, send her the letters and then the Red Cross packages that she asked for.
And keep sinking Japs. You see, that's all that you can do. It doesn't help to go out of your head.
I am not going out of my head.
Good. Neither am I. Not anymore.
Tell you something that I've discovered. Fighting a war is the best way to forget what it's all about. That's a very novel perception for me.
Enormously illuminating.
Les, just tell me the truth. What are Natalie's chances?
Byron. She's in a damnable situation. You know, she has been ever since Aaron refused to leave Italy back in 39. And now, the fat's in the fire. But you know, Natalie's tough and strong and clever. Just fight the war, Byron. Fight the war and try to put your wife out of your mind.
And if you are a praying man, pray.
I'll do some checking myself, and if I hear anything at all, I'll call you.
Bye, Les. Thanks a lot.
Bye, Byron.
Is that all, sir? Yeah, Reed, that's all.
So, how long will you be in Houston, huh?
Oh, about a week.
A week? Well, we'll miss Lucy's party, then.
Can't be helped.
Honestly, Pug, I thought this landing craft assignment would mean we'd see more of each other.
So did I, Ro.
You might see more of Janice and little Vic, too. You know, she writes she's thinking of moving to Washington.
Well, having a grandson around. That'd be nice.
She's talking about going to law school.
She may even move in with me for a little while.
That's fine. I'll get it.
Hi. Why don't you come in and say hi to my folks?
Okay. Hello, Mrs. Henry.
Sonny.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. You're still beached at that new weaponry laboratory, huh?
It's interesting duty, sir.
Heaven knows what he's up to. I can't pry a hint out of him.
Good.
Get used to it, my dear. They are all alike.
Well, we gotta run. We're gonna be late for the show.
Nice seeing you again, Sonny.
Nice seeing you. Good night.
You two enjoy yourselves. I like that boy.
Had a long talk with Madeline last night. Had to do with that radio person, Cleveland. She was in tears.
Now, don't tell me he's been phoning her again.
Oh, no. She's quit him and she's not going back, so just put away your horsewhip, pup. The Navy has carried the day. She expects him to propose any moment now.
Well, I hope she has the good sense to accept.
She'll pounce on him. Of course, she's utterly paralyzed about what to tell him about her escapades with Cleveland in New York.
I hope you told her to tell him the truth. Roe, what did you tell her?
I told her, wait till he asks.
Roe? Why don't we talk about Hack Peters, huh?
Yes, why not, dear? Better fix us a couple of stiff drinks.
Gone, you saw quite a bit of him, didn't you?
Yes, I did. But you have to understand the state I was in, Pug. I met him right after Warren. Well, I needed someone. With you gone and me all alone in this big house. But you must believe me, Pug. The whole thing has been completely innocent. Nothing has ever happened. He has been utterly irreproachable. It's true, Pug. Believe me. He seems to think I'm some kind of perfection of womankind. I mean, can you believe it, Pug? Me? It's almost embarrassing being so... just so idolized.
And since I've been back, have you still been seeing him?
A few times. He's very sweet, Pug, and he makes me feel 10 years younger.
Well, I guess the only question now is, would you be happier divorcing me and marrying him?
And forgiving, but after being loved by you for so many years, it's wretched just being tolerated. You wake up every morning knowing that's all there is.
Good, I'm sorry. I don't know what to say. I swear I never intended to make you feel that way.
Oh, but I know you didn't. Just the way it is. And I don't think it's ever going to change.
So, what do you want me to do?
I want you to be happy.
About the divorce, Rose. What do you want me to do about the divorce?
Divorce. I need some time to think. I'm sorry. I just don't know now.
Okay. You and Peters talk it over. Whatever you agree on is okay with me. I'll do whatever you want me to do. And that, Pamela darling, is how Rhoda and I finally, after all this time, came to grips with the problem I came racing home from Moscow to deal with. The long and short of it is, Harrison Peters is dying to marry her. No question. She's landed him. I realize that you may still be engaged, but too many people's happiness is at stake for that to matter if you want me as I want you. Marriage will not be, I grant you, like those tantalizing encounters in far-off places. But if God just gives you to me, I'll say, with everything that's gone wrong with my life, that I'm a happy man. And I'll try to make you happy. I hope this letter doesn't come too late. All my love, Victor.
Ah, Miss Tuthury.
Yes.
His lordship's been taken to the plane. There's a car waiting.
Very well, I'm ready.
Dearest Victor, I'm writing this en route from New Delhi to London, carrying Duncan home very much against his will for further medical treatment. He was terribly injured when his plane went down in a thunderstorm over Imphal. Broken collarbone, fractured ankles, and after a week on foot alone in the jungle, a high fever that will not seem to go away. During the past weeks, he's been very low and so dependent on me. Now in a quiet way, it almost seems as if we are married. Now, Victor, about your proposal. It fell on me like an avalanche just this morning. I put my arms around your neck and bless you, but the fact is, I've never pretended to him or to you that I feel for him the strange love that has bound us. But I'm about ready to give up passion as a bad job. I've not had much luck with it. Besides, I really don't quite believe your letter. I just know that Rhoda hasn't landed her new fellow yet. And until he's marched her into a church, she won't have. And if there's one thing I know beyond any question of a doubt, it's that you will always take Rhoda back. I love you. You know that. And I always will. I've never known anyone like you. Don't stop loving me. The whole thing was just fated not to be. Bad luck. Bad timing. Bad whatever. But it was beautiful. Don't ever forget.
Curtain rises on the third full year of World War II. Japan reels before an onslaught of massive U.S. war production and the improved skills of the American fighting man. From tropical New Guinea to the subarctic Aleutians, U.S. Marines and GIs are carrying the fight to the Japanese and winning. Bougainville, Eti Island, Tarawa Atoll, each a bloody stepping stone as Nimitz's fleet island hops inexorably across the Central Pacific to revenge Pearl Harbor and the GIs and Filipinos who fell at Bataan and Corregidor. But perhaps no branch of the American armed forces of the Pacific has struck a more devastating blow against the enemy than the U.S. Navy's submarine fleet. A new aggressive breed of skipper has taken the war into Japanese home waters. And by year's end, sunk 335 vessels. A staggering 1.5 million tons of shipping. Japan's losses are starting to outstrip her capacity to rebuild. and the attrition is seriously beginning to weaken her ability to make war.
With ammo.
I'll take it. Go. All hands hear this. That's number two today. A big fat ammo ship. We're now coming about to 130 in pursuit of the freighters that were with them. They're hightailing it for the Emperor's backyard and air cover. Well, we're gonna pursue them on the surface after dark and sink them in the morning. Now this is gonna be one hell of a patrol. Anybody sorry they came along?
No, sir.
Jax goes 20.
Hold. C-20. Up 40.
I just hope you guys aren't playing for money, huh?
No, sir.
Yeah, right. How you doing, Horseshoes?
Oh, you don't want to know, Mr. Henry. Say, that was good shooting today.
Well, we're not through yet, guys.
Well, I'll tell you something. Captain Astor wants to go to Tokyo Bay in the morning. We go with him.
Yeah, play that.
Let's not give him any ideas, all right? See you guys later.
Your bet.
How are we doing on fuel, Mr. Exec?
55,000 gallons, Skipper.
Not bad.
It's a nice night, isn't it?
I tell you, Byron, once we nail these two freighters up ahead and with that ammo ship in the bag, you can rotate me stateside anytime you want.
What about you? I guess Natalie's pretty much on your mind, isn't she?
Yeah, all the time. And the baby.
Yeah.
And Janice, too, for that matter.
Janice? Why Janice?
Oh, lady, I've treated her pretty bad.
What the hell are you talking about?
Look, things are out of hand. The truth is, we've fallen in love. I mean, it's my fault. I don't know what the hell possessed me all these months, but... Anyway, that letter from Natalie really woke me up. I gotta cut this thing off with Janice, and it's gonna be hell on both of us.
Look, Byron, you're lonesome. She is a beautiful woman. You're quite a guy. Sleeping under the same roof for crying out loud. I think you rate a Navy Cross for staying faithful.
Look, she's fallen for me because I encourage her. I mean, I've been pretty obvious about it. But the fact is, Natalie's alive. My wife is alive, and I've been a real bastard to Janice.
Oh, damn it, buddy, that tears at you. You gotta be living on another planet. It just never grew up. I don't.
What are you talking about?
Look, Janice and I have had something going for more than a year now.
What?
It's true. I promised her I wouldn't tell you.
What? A year?
Yeah.
You?
Yes, about that. Between your brother's death and you off in the med, she was a mighty sad cookie at the time. Don't get me wrong. She likes you. Maybe she even loves you. But damn it, she's only human. I mean, what harm have we done? She's a great kid. We had a lot of laughs. Hey, she was afraid of you and your father. She thought you'd disapprove. And obviously you do. Hey, come on. I don't know how your mind works, my friend, but don't waste any more energy feeling guilty about Janice, because that's a joke.
So... if he comes to the left. What if he maintains in that direction? Oh, good. The SJ radar's picked a hell of a time to crap out. We're socked in again. Visibility's down to 1,000 yards. We're trying to track him by sonar, but our last position is 2 hours old. And if he changes course, we could lose him. I don't see any reason why he'd change course, do you? You?
Not unless he's hightailing for port.
Let's maintain our course and speed.
Sleep?
Sure.
You still sore at me?
Why should I be? It took a load off my mind.
That was the idea.
They did change course.
Damn, one of them's gone.
Yeah, it's the same one, same smokestack and goalpost.
All ahead, flank. Come left to 135.
It's 5 miles. Unless he zigzags, he's made it.
All right, we can catch him.
What, you mean on the surface?
Right, on the surface.
Skipper, those freighters took evasive action. They're probably on full submarine alert. You have to assume they've been charting their course and speed all night and the planes are sweeping the area.
Steady on 130.
Lady, they could nail us any time now.
It's a great morning, huh? Sound the happy hunting horn.
Listen to me. We're still inside the shipping lane. Plenty of other targets are becoming along. Let's pull the plug.
The freighters are our pigeon. We've been tracking them all night, and we are going to get them. Now, isn't that beautiful? Okay, now, take it down.
Aye, sir.
Aircraft dead astern! 2-0's coming in low!
Clear the bridge!
Take it down! Die! Die! Go, go, go!
Paradise Ghetto has a new commandant, SS Major Karl Rahm. Showing Rahm around the ghetto is Camp Inspector Scharfuhrer Rudolf Heindl. This Austrian with a cigarette obsession is a feared and loathed man. For possessing a single cigarette, he will beat a victim half to death or send him to the little fortress to be tortured. Rumor has it that Burger, the low SS thug who kicked and berated me in Eichmann's presence, did not show enough enthusiasm for Eichmann's great beautification of Theresienstadt plan, and so was replaced. But at least Burger was the devil we knew. With him, life in the ghetto was wretched, but it was stable. There have been no new transports to the east for many weeks. What will the unknown devil bring?
Theresienstadt is run down. Filthy, like a pigsty. I will not tolerate it. like my predecessor, I propose to make the great beautification my prime concern. The Regentstadt is going to become the paradise ghetto in fact, as well as in name. I've issued important orders. The old soccer hall will be rebuilt at once as a community center with studios and lecture halls and an opera house and a theater with the fully equipped stages. The cabarets will be enlarged and decorated. The tents will be removed from the square and the beautiful garden will be laid for the leisure of the old people. The hospitals are going to be spick and span. We will build a playground for the children and a fine school with the very best textbooks. And
I have long suspected that Eichmann made me a figurehead elder, possibly even sent me to Theresienstadt in anticipation of a visit by neutral observers. Window dressing, the eminent American writer.
And we must make sure that
something like that now seems to be in the wind. It is whispered that the International Red Cross is coming to inspect the Paradise Ghetto in late spring or early summer. Unfortunately, this will do nothing to improve the lot of the ghetto residents. So what Sturmbannfuhrer Rahm is actually proposing is the painting of a corpse.
And so, as you can all see, we have a big job before us. And as you Jews are to be the chief beneficiaries, I expect you to make suggestions as to how we should proceed. Well, I am not talking for my health. Your suggestions! Yeah.
Herr Commandant, I am the stinking Jew, Jastrow.
Now then, that will cease at once. New regulations. No more idiotic saluting and taking hats off. And no more stinking Jew talk.
Jawohl, Herr Commandant.
Theresienstadt is not a concentration camp. It is a comfortable and happy residential town. Understood? Speak!
If I may mention, Herr Commandant, in my department, the music section badly needs paper.
Paper? What kind of paper?
Any kind, mein Commandant. Though ruled musical score paper would, of course, be best.
Ruled musical score paper. How much?
500 sheets to start with.
See to it.
Jawohl, Herr Commandant.
Thank you, sir. You see, gentlemen, these are the kind of ideas that I want. What else?
Soccer teams. We could organize soccer teams, Herr Commandant, if we are supplied footballs and a suitable field.
Excellent. It will be done. Your suggestion? Sit down. There's one final item to be discussed. Sturmbannfuhrer Rahm has confided to me that he finds the overcrowded conditions in Theresienstadt most unhealthy and unsightly, not quite suited to a great beautification. So he has ordered that we... that we at once select 5,000 residents for transport to the east. Mummelstein will now give you your allotments. You will turn in your list to the Transport Commission by 3 o'clock this afternoon.
Non-working juveniles, 1,000. Over 65, 1,000. Economic Department, 500. Finance Department, 250. Technical Department, 600. Art and Culture, 150. Medical Department, 300.
And so today, I begin to pay the price of my exalted status as an elder.
Yes, Natalie, I'm afraid so.
Surely there's something we could do. Must be some way to get you an exemption. I'll talk to Aaron.
It won't do any good, Natalie. Everything that can be done has been done. Tomorrow at 6, I must collect Marta and go to the depot.
The puppet shows they found out.
Oh, no, Natalie, don't worry. I went by your apartment earlier. No transport notifications. Believe me. You and your uncle have the highest exam classifications.
Oh, Udam.
I've come up with some new jokes for tonight. Let's go inside and rehearse them.
Anyway, with the train leaving tomorrow, I don't think anyone will be in the mood to laugh.
Natalie, it's the reason to make them laugh.
My Theresienstadt friends, I have no heart tonight for a lecture. I will put aside my professorial notes. They are neat, bloodless, and irrelevant. My topic was to be the Book of Job. That's what I'll talk about, but not as a professor.
As one of you, a Theresienstadt Jew.
Satan said to God, do you remember? Naturally, Job is upright. 7 sons, 3 daughters, the wealthiest man in the land of Uz. Why not be upright? See how it pays. But Job is not upright. He's just a smart Jew, sneers Satan. But take away his rewards and see how upright he will remain. So God allows Satan to put Job through every trial but death. All his children die. All his wealth is wiped out. A horrible sickness strikes him. And so, reduced by a whim of God to a broken, loathsome, plundered skeleton covered with sores, Job sits on the ash heap. Naked I came from the womb, he says. Naked will I return. God has given, God has taken away. Blessed be God's name.
Amen.
Job has stood up to Satan's test. The oldest problem of human existence. Senseless evil. But now comes a worse trial, a worse test. Job's comforters come. Passionately they urge him to admit that since God is just, Job must have committed some terrible sin. Search your deeds, repent, confess. But Job fights back. I have not sinned. I will submit to the divine will, but not to pious platitudes. And so, in the depths of his most terrible hour, Job rises to stand toe to toe with God and demand an answer to the great ultimate human mystery of senseless evil. Why do you do this to me? Well, Job gets his answer. An answer that answers nothing. God himself speaks to Job at last out of a roaring storm. Who are you to call me to account? Can you hope to understand how or why I do anything? My universe is vast beyond human conception. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the world? When the morning stars sang together and all the sons of heaven shouted for joy? Can you comprehend the infinite mysteries of existence? You, a poor worm who lives for a few moments and dies. An answer that answers nothing and everything. The roaring storm has declared only that God's reason is hidden beyond Job, beyond the comforters. The universe doesn't always make sense. There is no guarantee of good fortune for good behavior. Crazy injustice is part of the enigma of the world and of our brief lives. Job humbles himself, is more than satisfied, and falls upon his face. My Theresienstadt friends, this is the thought I would leave with you tonight. Who is it in history who suffers ordeal after ordeal? Plundering after plundering, massacre after massacre, century after century. Yet looks up at the sky, sometimes with dying eyes, and cries, Lord our God, the Lord is one. Who until then will leave the fearful mystery of undeserved suffering to God and praise his name, saying, the Lord has given, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Nobody, my friends, but that loathsome, bereaved skeleton on the ash heap. Nobody but Job. He is the only answer, if there is one, to the satanic challenge to an almighty God. Job, the stinking Jew.
Gut gesucht, Arava. Und gut getan.
Tribulation, Natalie.
There.
Of being an elder. But how on earth did you find out where we were? And how did you get past the guards? It's very dangerous.
So long you might say. It's too long a story. I'm in the Prague underground now. We can do many things. Natalie, since I found you and Arla were here, I've been making arrangements.
St. Louis? Why? He's fine. He's healthy. He's actually thriving here.
Natalie, you know the dangers. This ghetto is a pest hole of malnutrition and sickness. Besides, God knows what the SS may decide to do with the kids one day or with all of you. No, right.
Child will be hospitalized with some false diagnosis. Then a death certificate will be provided to the central secretarial file. Maybe even a fake burial or cremation.
Oh, my God.
After that, we'll secretly move him to Prague. From there, I'll take him to a farm where he'll live with some wonderful people. You can get news of him, I promise you, all the time. Natalie, the children, Zaza and the Ossid,
they are the future that must be saved.
This might be the best thing for Louis, Natalie.
The best thing for Louis is to be with his mother every day.
There are transports to the east.
What except?
Natalie.
I won't hear it. I will not be separated from Louis.
Ever get near Prague. Maybe even if the Americans land in France, the SS will launch a mass killing action here in the ghetto.
We are planning an uprising if that happens. Well, that will be a desperate business. And God knows who will survive.
Well, I'll do my best to try to convince her.
I've come from the east, from Oshie and Jim.
Rhoda? Rhoda, what is it?
Oh, I'm all right, Pug. Just go to sleep.
Let me in.
The door's not locked, Pug. Oh, I'm sorry. Was I making a racket? I tried to keep it low.
What's up?
Oh, I'm done for. Everything is ruined. You're well rid of me.
I think you could use a drink.
I look gruesome, don't I?
Why don't you come on downstairs in the library and we'll have a talk?
You're an angel. A brandy. A big brandy. I'll be right down. Better?
Much.
I washed my face and flung myself into bed hours and hours ago. And then I just couldn't sleep.
Why, Rhoda? Not because I have to see Colonel Peters tomorrow. It's just a business meeting. I told you that. Maybe I shouldn't have mentioned it, but, you know, I wouldn't cause you any trouble.
Pug, someone's been writing hack anonymous letters. Oh, I know. Pam told me you got some, too. It's really gotten under his skin.
Any idea who's writing the letters?
No. Oh, it's a woman. Some vicious bitch. Oh, they abound, Pug. They do abound. It's just so unfair. I didn't even know Hack then. Now, did I? I mean, you talk about your double standards. Oh, to hear him talk, he has been to bed with everyone. I mean, single, married, divorced, he makes no bones about it. He even reminisces, the whole point being every time how different I am. And I am, too. I am. I mean, there was only Palmer Kirby. I don't know how or why that happened. But I am not one of those cheap flirts he has run around with all his life. I mean, these letters are ruining everything. He seems so crushed. Well, of course, I denied everything. I mean, I had to for his sake. I must say, for such an experienced man, he is strangely naive. Well, say something, Pug. Don't just sit there like a sphinx.
If the man loves you, he'll believe you, Rhoda.
Will he now? And what if he asks you about them tomorrow?
We have an urgent priority problem to thrash out tomorrow. He's not going to bring up anything personal, and certainly not those anonymous letters. Not to me.
Wish I could be so sure.
Forget it, Rhoda. Go to bed. Pleasant dreams.
Could I have another drinky?
Sure.
Will you tell me afterward what happened?
If anything personal turns up, I will tell you.
Thank you, Pug. You are so wonderful.
Feeling better, aren't you?
Heaps. You're sweet to be so reassuring, Pug. It's just that when you told me you were going to see him tomorrow, I... Well, Hack can't possibly ask Palmer. He just isn't done, you know. Palmer wouldn't tell him anything anyway. Well, I mean, you're the only other one who knows. You're the aggrieved husband. I just got to thinking about all sorts of awful possibilities.
Actually, I didn't know anything until tonight.
Of course you knew. Don't be like that, Pug. How could you not know?
all about?
Well, I'm sort of waked up now. I think I'll do a little work.
Smoke cigars, Henry?
By all means.
Before we get down to business, there's something I'd like to say. I have the greatest deal of respect for you. Rhoda is what she is, a woman in a million. Because of the years she spent with you. Now, I regret we haven't yet had the opportunity to talk about that. We've both been busy as hell. But one day, we'll have to.
Yes, we will.
I'm sorry I was slow getting back to you.
I guess that phone call from Harry Hopkins helped. Colonel. To shortcut this a bit, I have top security clearance. I know that the Army is working on a uranium bomb with blank check AAA priority power. That's why I'm here. The landing craft program can use those couplings that I mentioned to you on the phone, which you have preempted.
Sorry, I can't give them to you.
We're talking about components for 40 vessels, Colonel. If they're launched on time, Eisenhower can hit those French beaches with a hell of a lot more force than he would otherwise.
Captain, our requirements are the same as yours, but our urgency is much greater.
I have an idea that might solve this problem. I've checked all the stuff that the manufacturers have on hand. They can modify a larger coupling to meet your specs, and the delay would only be about 10 days. Now, supposing I take some samples down to your plant and talk with your engineers.
Not a chance.
A bit less messy than going to the president, which I am also prepared to do.
Well, then you'll just have to go to the president. I can't help you.
Okay. I will.
Captain Henry. Let me check into one possibility. I'll call you before noon.
I'll wait for your phone call.
What do you think, McDermott? Can you use that thing?
With a modified sleeve and a bigger gasket, it'll work.
Thanks, Mac.
Well, will that do it, Colonel?
Yeah, we'll check back in Washington.
Here you are, Captain. Good luck.
Thanks, Mac.
No, thanks.
Bug Henry.
Don't you want a drink with me? You know, I was
talking to Rhoda. She was talking to me about that Anderson fella. Seemed like a real comer. He's on development of that Navy process in Anacostia. Rhoda says that he and Madeline are serious. Well, you'd approve, wouldn't you?
Yep. Well, I think I'll turn it.
Pug, look, I'd like to ask you a very personal question.
I don't want to disturb you, Pug, but it's damn important to me.
Okay, go ahead.
Why did you and Rhoda ever break up? It wasn't my doing, was it? I mean, believe me, I'm not so rotten I would move in on a guy's wife when he's overseas.
I believe you.
You and Rhoda, you're two of the finest people I know. What happened? Dr. Fred Kirby have anything to do with this?
What kind of a question is that?
I've been getting letters, Bug. Vicious, anonymous letters. About Rhoda and Kirby. I'm ashamed of myself for paying them any attention, but...
You should be. Fred Kirby's an old friend of mine. We met when I was stationed in Berlin. Rhoda had to come home when the war broke out. Fred was in Washington. Played tennis with her, took her to shows and such. Sort of what you've been doing, except without the complications. I knew about it and I appreciated it. I don't much like this conversation, Colonel. I'd like to turn in.
Sorry, Pug.
Okay, good night.
It's because I idolize Rhoda that I'm so upset. I'm more than upset. It's driving me crazy. I've known a hell of a lot of women, but maybe sexier than Rhoda, prettier. But she's virtuous. That's why she's so precious to me. I know this may sound strange coming from me, but how I feel. She's darn near perfect. She's elegant, modest, decent, truthful. She never lies. You know women, Pug, they lie the way they breathe. You know that. But Rhoda, Rhoda, she's different. Finest lady I've ever known. That's why this thing hit me like an earthquake. If I've offended you in any way at all, Pug, I'm sorry. Because I think the world of you, Pug.
Colonel, we have a very busy day tomorrow. Good night.
Thanks, Buck.
Hi, Matt.
Hello, sir. Good to see you again.
Hello, Sam.
Well, return of the warrior. You remembered you had a family, how nice.
What is all this?
Are you going to be busy next Saturday?
Not that I know of, no.
Oh, no? Well, fine. How about coming to St. John's Church, then, and giving Madeline away to the sailor boy?
Well, congratulations. Oh.
Welcome aboard. Well, thank you, sir. Chalk one up for the name.
A little toasty? Refill, please. Well, the last fledgling takes wing. At least she made it before the mother flew away. Oh, by the way, there was a letter from Byron. In all the excitement, I clean forgot.
Any real news?
Well, the first patrol was a success, and he qualified for command, and, you know Byron. He doesn't say much. Well, how was your trip? Was Hack helpful?
Decidedly. Well, I said I'd tell you of any personal talk between me and Peters.
So? Go ahead.
You were right. Those letters are eating him. I spent half of one night backing up your story. Lied like a thief, in fact. I did the very best I could for you.
Did he believe you?
I thought so.
Well, you were very, very gallant. Thank you, Pug, and God bless you.
That's not the end of it.
What do you mean?
He caught me the next morning in the dining car. He asked for coffee right off, and then he said, I take it that you preferred not to give me a straight answer about Dr. Kirby last night.
What did you say to that?
Well, he caught me off guard, you realize. I said, how could I have been any straighter, or something like that? And he said, and I'm trying for his exact words, Pug, I'm not about to cross-examine you, and I'm not about to throw Rhoda over, but I think I deserve the truth. A marriage shouldn't start with a lie. If you get the chance to tell Rhoda that, please do. It might help clear the air.
Well, I'm sure you did the very best you could. You're just not a very good lawyer, bud. That damn woman of couldn't find her. I would.
Hey! You are drunk as a skunk.
Why not?
Rhoda, he is not throwing you over.
Oh. No, of course not. Well, you go through with it. Soul of honor and all that. I'll probably have to let him. I mean, what's my alternative? Still, it's ruined.
Ro, why don't you just tell him? No, I mean it. Look at Madeline and Cy. She told him about Cleveland. They couldn't be happier.
Oh, Pug, my poor, dumb love. What kind of a comparison is that? I mean, look at me. I'm a hag. I mean, Slimy is not 30 years old, and Madeline is a luscious young girl. The hack is fastened onto me, and it's all very charming, but at our age, it's mostly mental. And now I'm cornered. I'm damned if I do, and I'm damned if I don't. I'm a good wife. I'm a good wife. I could make him very happy. You know that, and he had to have this perfect picture of me, and now it's gone.
It was an illusion.
What's wrong with an illusion? I'm sorry. I didn't mean to be all. I'm sorry. I think I better go to bed.
Good.
Pug. Oh, thank you. Thank you for trying. Save it for Pamela, honey.
Pamela turned me down.
Oh, and she didn't.
Indeed, she did.
My gosh, you're close enough. Why? How could she? She marrying Burnwell?
She hasn't yet. But she said no. That's it.
And you just accepted.
How can I not accept it?
I have just spotted enough to send you. You go after her. You romance her. You court her. That's all she wants.
I don't think she's like that. That letter was pretty final.
We're all like that. Don't you ever. I declare I am really stone drunk. You may have to help me up the stairs.
Okay, let's go.
No. I was just fooling. You drink your brandy. I navigate.
You're sure?
I always have. Night, love.
May 11th, 1944. With the Red Cross visit drawing nearer, Commandant Rahm is getting nervous about his ability to hold them to the restricted route. Therefore, he has decided to clean up the entire ghetto. The first step is to again relieve the overcrowding. And so the sluice to the east has once more been opened.
Yes.
All Jews now in Theresienstadt, 35,000. Protected by the Germans, 9,500. Protected by the Central Secretariat, 6,500. Total protected, 16,000. Available for transport, 19,000.
Ordered for transport, 7,500. One-fifth of the entire ghetto. Didn't you protest?
Herr Professor...
Controlling figures are burned in my brain. Transports will go in three trains in three successive days. First one 4 days from now, May the 15th. Oh, the grating irony. May the 15th, the date the Theresienstadt people have been waiting and praying for, the rumored date of the long-awaited Allied landings in Europe. Transport will badly disrupt the beautification. But Rahm is unconcerned. He is warned that the work will be done. Those in charge will be sorry. I still cannot believe that so blatant a comedy can hoodwink anybody. What are the Germans hoping to gain by it? Jews are disappearing. Millions are gone. Can this vast horror be long concealed?
Yes, yes.
There is no sense to it. It is the backward child on a monumental and terrible scale, caught at the empty jam jar, his face, hands, clothes smeared red, smiling and denying that he ate the jam.
Natalie, I'm heartsick about this transport. You know, Rahm has ordered all the orphans to be shipped out as well. Visitors asking a child about its parents mustn't hear that they're dead or transported. Half my Talmud class is already going. Natalie, do you hear me?
It's a mistake.
They delivered them to me at the toddler's home. One for me, one for Lewis. We're on the third train on the 17th. To be resettled in the direction of Dresden.
Natalie, listen to me.
Our transport numbers are printed right on the card, see? to take Lewis to the Hamburg barracks on the 16th. Not very much luggage, they say. It wouldn't change it much.
Listen, you must listen to me, Natalie. You're prominent. Like a worker, the headmistress of the children's pavilion. There must be some mistake.
I don't think so, Aaron.
What do you mean?
I'm afraid it's my own doing. I didn't want to worry you, but our group's been planning a way to get the Red Cross to see beyond what the Germans want them to see. Maybe there was an informer.
Natalie, I've warned you repeatedly. These clandestine Zionist activities are bound to get you into trouble someday. You should at least have allowed Beryl to take Lewis out of here. Still, there's no need to panic, my dear. Not to come to any rash conclusions. That transport section is a madhouse. Someone might easily have pulled the wrong card. I'll be with you within the hour.
Yes, of course, a mistake is not at all unlikely. Well, you know what it's like in the transport section, eh? People running around without heads. I will look into it.
I can't tell you how I appreciate this, Dr. Epstein.
Herr Professor, your niece, she hasn't been up to any mischief by chance, has she?
Nothing of the kind, certainly not.
No, of course not.
Well, Doctor, I know you're a very busy man, so I won't keep you from your work. But perhaps you should have these notifications with you when you're making your inquiries at the transport section.
No, let her keep them. Don't confuse things. When the error has been corrected, she will be contacted to give them in.
Of course, that's obviously the best way to handle it. Thank you again, Doctor.
Herr Professor.
Days gone by. The second train has already left. No news from him. I am an elder. Is he in his office?
No, he is not.
I shall go to the transport section.
Do as you please, Professor.
Stein wouldn't see you. I didn't think he would.
No, but there's real news. The transport section has made a gross error.
What kind of error?
More than 8,000 summonses went out. There was only room for 7,500 transportees. At least 500 may be cancelled.
Well, that's marvelous news. Aaron, do you really suppose they'll cancel the summons of someone accused of plotting against the Reich?
No more of that, Natalie. You were just following your conscience.
I was, you know. I really was. Even now, I don't regret what I did. Except you were right, Aaron. I should have jumped to Beryl's offer to get Lewis out of here before taking such risks. You know, Aaron, My parents will be very important. Now that I'm no longer going to be shielded by a famous uncle. I'll be on my own. It's not my best. Perhaps if I can rouse the instant favor of the SS where it is I'm going and identify myself as an American and a prominent. Maybe it'll help.
Yes, of course, Zalia. Excellent thinking.
So, do you think I should wear this on the train? It is rather seductive.
Well, no, I'd advise not. It might provoke liberties from the Germans. They're nothing for the worst kind of Jews. Well, now, what about this one? Tailored, muted, elegant, even faintly Germanic. Besides, it suits your pretty figure to perfection. You and Lewis will make a splendid impression on your arrival.
Yes, Aaron, you're right. It's all that settled. What else to take? We're allowed so little, and that's the food I have to carry.
Natalie, I'm going to follow up that matter of the cancelled summonses. I'm going to see Ryman in his office.
Aaron, I don't think that's a good idea. You know what he's like.
Well, Epstein maintains that Brahms' bark is far worse than his bite. The moment his rages are over, he's perfectly easy to talk to.
All right. Please be careful.
What time do you have to report to the transport barracks?
3, no later.
Well, I shan't be long. Goodbye, little fellow. And may God watch over you. High Elder Jastrow, I respectfully request permission to see the Herr Kommandant Rahm.
Was ist los? Was fällt Ihnen ein?
It is in connection with the beautification project.
Warten Sie gefälligst am Flur. Man wird Sie aufrufen. You will be called. Da an der Treppe! Desserts, desserts! Da warten! Wait!
Thank you.
in anymore. Mommy's going to take you for a walk now.
Crime which I wish to confess to you.
What crime?
No.
I bought them in Rome, Herr Commandant, in 1940 for $25,000. As a prominent, I was not searched on my arrival at Theresienstadt, so was able to withhold them. I seriously regret this very serious offense, but, and came here to make a clean breast of it. It seemed to me better to hand them over directly to the Herr Commandant because of their great value.
Their great value? You probably bought them from some swindling old Jew. And they're class.
No, no, no. I assure you, Herr Commandant, it was from the finest jeweler in Italy.
Have you got any more little things hidden away?
There is nothing else, Herr Commandant.
Oh. And your, Jew whore niece knows all about them?
No, no, no. I told her nothing of it. I thought it wiser so. No one in the world knows about them, Herr Commandant, except you and me. There was an excessive summonses. I understand there will be many cancellations.
She don't!
She's lucky she wasn't sent to the little fortress and shot! Get up. I said get out!
Commandant, I must tell you, if my niece is transported, I shall resign from being elder. I shall resign from the library. I will take no part in the beautification. I will not talk to the Red Cross visitors that come to visit my apartment. Nothing on earth will force me to change my mind.
Do you want to commit suicide immediately, Jew?
Herr Commandant. Herr Eichmann took great pains to bring me from Paris to Theresienstadt. Why? Because I make good window dressing. My picture has been taken by the German journalists, and my books are published in Denmark. And the Danish members of the Red Cross will be very interested in meeting
me. Shut your dribbling mouth and get out of here at once! Unless you wish to die.
Herr Commandant, I haven't much to live for. I'm not well, and I'm old. Kill me, and you will have to explain to Herr Eichmann what has become of his window dressing. Torture me, and if I survive, what effect shall I make on the Red Cross? But if you cancel my niece's summons, I guarantee our cooperation when the Red Cross comes. And I guarantee that she will do no more foolish things.